Look, no matter how much work, luck, saving, discipline, rate of return, financial advice, or information you consume, if you don't get this one piece right, you're gonna be broke. If you think money is the root of all evil and that someone with money had to do something wrong, bad, or deceptive, this misinformation will keep you broke. There are those thieves that steal money without value, but their time will come. It's your time to unlock your potential, embrace the principles of prosperity, and claim money that's rightfully yours. See, there's a prevailing belief. It's subtle, but it's destructive and damaging. You can hear it in YouTube comments, and I'll go through some of them that I see on this channel. See, I'm just committed to contributing to this community, to adding value, to liberating people from the tyranny of misinformation, the pain of money mistakes, and ultimately those myths that hold people back. But some of those comments are, for example, I wish I was meant for this, but my reality is I'm not. This may work in the US, but not in the UK. There isn't a clear path to getting to the 1%. This is for the ultra rich and not the norm. Most people can't handle the responsibility of being rich. See, if these are your thoughts, then you're gonna find the reality of matching those thoughts. In one of the videos, Robert Kiyosaki says, going into debt makes money, right? And then someone else says, that's insane. But they're not really considering inefficient versus efficient loans. Or there's other people that say, this isn't recession proof. Or they may have logic, but it's risky logic. So what's the number one thing that will keep you poor? Is it your family? Is it where you live? Is it your job? No. The number one thing that keeps millions of people poor, just like you, is your perspective. Let me break this down into three perspectives, and if you can change these, it's gonna release you from being poor. Number one, do you believe there's only a finite amount of wealth, or that those that have more than you have taken all the opportunities and there's less for others? There's something I call a producer versus a consumer. A producer seeks to create more value in the world than they take from it. A consumer, on the other hand, looks to take more than they give. And consumers are always gonna be broke. People in the consumer condition, that's the paradigm I'm talking about, it's almost like a disease where they think, you know, they feel entitled. They feel like if someone has something, it's because they stole it from another. And they consistently look for someone to do something for them rather than do something for themselves, where the producer paradigm is a place where people consistently look to add value. They're constantly questioning, like, what can I do to impact more people? And it's a place where innovation and ingenuity are the norm. And that people in the producer paradigm believe that profit is evidence of value creation, where the consumer condition, they believe that profit is evidence of coercion and deception. So think about it. If you want to be a good person, but you have these faulty beliefs, then obviously you're going to avoid or push money away because you don't want to be bad or deceptive or greedy or all the things that can come with. Look, some of the most major corporations are greedy SOBs. Some of the people out there that have plenty of money, they've been doing it by stealing. But like I said, the day will come. I believe in karma. There will be a reckoning. The key is not to let that defeat your mindset or debilitate your actions. So the second thing. The second thing that's so detrimental here is if you heard your family or key people in your life talk about how having too much money is bad, that it's somehow something that is going to corrupt them. Those that think it's impossible to get ahead or that wealth comes from those deceptive things, well, they're gonna consistently find it to be elusive. They're gonna see it out of reach. They're gonna be constantly conflicted, like, I wanna do this, but I wanna be a good person. So if you wanna be a good person, you'll just remain stuck. I call that a dilemma. Dilemmas are misleading. Like, a dilemma would be someone saying, well, I want a really nice home, but I don't wanna have so much of a home that it creates jealousy or that it somehow says something bad about me. Or I hear people say, well, I don't care about a nice vehicle. Now, if they had the money, maybe they would care about it, but maybe because they don't, they justify it away. Really, this is about your personal preferences and not looking at your existing circumstance and then saying, yeah, I'm this way because I'm a good person. You're in the sacrifice mode, and sacrifice is where you give up better for something temporarily that seems to have the moral ground. But is it moral to add less value? Is it moral to, you know, create less exchange? Is it moral to take your very best gifts and hold them within you rather than bring it to the world? Like, money follows value. Dollars follow value, it chases value. So how can you become a value creator? And just because you have money doesn't mean you're a bad person, because even if there's a finite amount of money, that money can circulate. And the more times it circulates, there's goods, there's services, there's experiences, the wealthier we all become. It's not a zero-sum game. It's not one wins at the expense of the other. As a matter of fact, I believe we all have a sole purpose, and to discover yours, you can go to wealthfactory.com/solution. It's the question I get most often. And that solution is giving you a guide to discover more of the best of who you are, to uncover the things that a lot of times we discount because we think everyone's good at it, but the reality is it might be your very best gift, and if you don't bring it to the world, wealth will always be elusive. So if you have a money map that's off, if you have a money mindset that's misinformed, you're gonna consistently push this away in the name of being a good person. But good people add value. Good people serve others. Good people become, you know, a way that can improve strangers' lives, and those strangers can exchange by giving you money. So the third piece is, do you think other people just have advantages you don't? Like, is that just part of the vernacular and the conversation? Because wealth is built through our conversations, and if we have poverty-based conversations, that tends to lead towards inaction. That tends to lead towards blame and victimhood. But we want you to be a victor. So to be a victor, what do you really want? Like, if you took money out of the equation and you could accomplish anything that you wanted, what would you do if money wasn't an obstacle, if money wasn't a concern, if you had an unlimited bank account? What one action can you take today to make progress? Sometimes this global economy is so insurmountable. There's so many problems all the time, and no one individual can fix all those problems. No one policy in the government can make it all better. And the reality is that can become overwhelming, but if we just look instead and say, what one step can I take today? What one thing I can do to create confidence, progress, and value, and then consistently ask that question and then expand those possibilities? See, the advantage comes from, you know, really trying things and being willing to make mistakes. I think that some people try to avoid mistakes so much that that's their big mistake. I made mistakes in real estate back when I did real estate. I've made mistakes in business that cost me money, that caused pain for me and even for others. And if we try to be perfect with all these things, then we just never take any level of action. But think about being a little kid. We don't go, oh, they fell the first time they tried to walk. We don't want them to fall again and prevent them from ever walking. But we do that in business all the time. Part of it's because we're worried about what others think about us. People's opinion is none of my business. My business is my mission. 1 million people liberated so they're economically independent. 1 people freed so they have a better mindset and they embrace abundance. And really, I'm doing this and I'm not sitting here pitching my book all the time, although that really pisses people off. Like, oh, if you sell a book, you're somehow wrong, bad. Like, what? If I'm gonna share bits and pieces in 10 to 20 minutes, you think there might not be more to give someone in a book? Because I've written a lot of them. Killing Sacred Cows, 5-Day Weekend, What Would the Rockefellers Do, The Money Tree, and even Portal to Genius, and I've just written Win Then Play, and I'm coming out with Budgeting Sucks. Why? Because I was tired of hearing people say, but I only know this 10 years earlier. I wish I would have known this 20 years earlier. They're operating in the wrong mindset, governed by scarcity, destroying their prosperity, and ultimately not building a life that they love. So I've even given them away for free, wealthfactory.com/megakit, let you download 2 of my books. I'm here to make an impact, and I know if I stay committed to that value, there's gonna be people that love that value and they wanna engage further. But I'm making sure to give that right here and give you enough that you can put on the ground and implement to improve your life, but you've gotta get over that level of thinking that says, this is only for rich people, or I could never do this because of whatever excuse you have in your life. I had a friend, Sean Stevenson, he recently died. 3 feet tall, osteogenesis imperfecta, has broken hundreds of times his bones over his lifetime. Was told, his mom was told he wouldn't make it the first 24 hours, and she said, oh, I'd be lucky to make it 48 hours, then 72 hours, then 1 week, then 2 weeks, and he was on this earth for over 40 years. And this guy was here to rid insecurities. He made a massive impact. I've watched him speak. I watched the Dalai Lama hand him something over his, you know, shoulders. I watched him create a show on Bravo called The 3-Foot Giant. Like, he was able to have insurmountable odds that he overcame because he became an abundant thinker. And his mom once told him, she goes, this can either be a blessing or a curse. You get to choose. So what's your choice around your prosperity, around your money, and around your results? Are they limited by the philosophies that govern your actions, or what the government tells you, or what well-intentioned family and friends say that might not serve you? See, money is not a zero-sum game. It's not a win-lose game. It doesn't require one person to, you know, sacrifice for the other person to win. You can add value, and dollars will follow that value. So what are your best ways you can create more value? No amount of luck, discipline, savings, rate of return, or circumstance will save someone trapped by the scarcity mentality. I want you to embrace abundance because now you have the knowledge to transform your thoughts into profits and build the life you love. If you're looking for more on this topic, check out my video series on finding your soul purpose, S-O-U-L, your soul purpose. It's who you are when at your best, and it helps you enhance your skill sets and do it in an accelerated way. If you want to learn how hard work doesn't pay off, and because you're working hard but moving in the wrong direction, this is going to help unveil it. for you. So I'll see you there. We're in a society that wants results without reason, success without principle, and to be famous without value. We've got to get more clear about purpose.